Okay, good morning and welcome everyone to the 13th meeting of the Local Government Communities Committee. Can I remind everyone present to turn off mobile phones, and as meeting papers are provided in digital format, tablets may be used by members during the meeting. So that's what we're doing if you see us on our iPads or whatever. We have one apology this morning from our Deputy Commissioner Elaine Smith, who won't be able to with us this morning, unfortunately. And we move to agenda item one, which is decision on taking business in private. The committee is invited to consider whether to take item eight, consideration of its draft letter to the Scottish Government on local government elections and voting in private. Are we all agreed? Okay, thank you, members. We now move to agenda item two, subordinate legislation. The committee will take evidence in parts 2, 3, and 5 of the Community Empowerment Scotland Act 2015. And at this point, can I welcome Kevin Short, Minister for Local Government and Housing. Good morning, Minister.
Good morning.
Thank you for coming along. And can I also welcome officials from the Scottish Government Community Planning and Empowerment Unit, David Millen, Ian Turner, and Jean Waddy. Thank you very much for coming along this morning. It's appreciated. One of the instruments, asset transfer request designation of relevant authority Scotland orders 2017 SSI 2016 in draft, is laid under affirmative procedure, which means the Parliament must approve it before the provisions come into force. At such sessions, the Minister would ordinarily attend to provide evidence in relation to the affirmative instrument. However, given the committee agreed to consider the suite of community empowerment regulations as a package, there are several of them, it will also ask questions in relation to negative instruments, which are also be considered later on in the agenda today. Following this evidence session, the committee will be invited at the next agenda items to consider a motion to approve the affirmative instrument, followed by an item asking members to confirm whether it wishes to take any further action in relation to the negative instruments. So are we all following that? I hope so. And I know the Minister would like to make some opening remarks. So Kevin Short, can I ask you to make some opening remarks to the committee?
Thank you very much, Convener. Delighted to be here to talk about community empowerment today. And I'm very pleased to be bringing these parts of the Act into effect. I've been working with and for communities for some time, from my days working in the community on Aberdeen City Council as convener of the predecessor committee to this one, and now as minister. This is a very important issue for me, and I want to see our communities in control and having opportunities to shape the decisions that affect them. The Community Empowerment Act marks an important step in that process, and the parts that we are focusing on just now are perhaps some of the most significant aspects of the Act. We want our public services to work more effectively together and with communities, drawing on everyone's knowledge and abilities to achieve the best possible outcomes in the areas which will make the greatest difference to people's lives. Community planning is where all that comes together. The Act sets out a process where communities and public service providers will come together to decide what are their top priorities for their areas and how to address them. This includes planning at a locality level for those communities which experience particularly poor outcomes, of course taking into account the distinctive needs of different communities. I believe that more local focus is the key to encouraging communities to get involved. And once they get involved with community planning, and authorities see the benefits of working with community bodies in that context, I'm sure it will help to promote greater participation across all the areas of their work. If communities feel that they're not getting a chance to be involved in decisions about services, they will be able to make a participation request. That is another part of giving communities the confidence that they have the right to be heard and, of course, taken seriously, and make sure that public authorities also get that message loud and clear. Asset transfer is a powerful way of supporting communities to become more sustainable, improve outcomes, and to reduce inequalities. The Scottish Government has supported community ownership for many years, and there are many examples around the country of projects that have made a huge difference in their area. You heard from community stakeholders at an earlier session about these benefits. But there are still too many community bodies that are thwarted in trying to take over land or premises that could be providing real benefits to local people. I hope the legislation in Part 5 of the Act will unlock some of these cases. It will make sure that authorities make a decision within a reasonable time and provide a proper explanation for any refusal, which of course is open to appeal to Scottish ministers. It's a statutory procedure, and inevitably there is a degree of process that is involved. These are public assets, and it is right that community bodies have to show that they are ready to take them on and have a realistic, sustainable plan with broad support from the community. But where they can do that, they should be given the opportunity and, of course, the support to make a go of it. Of course, we cannot legislate for behaviour and attitudes. We cannot force people to get on. There is a culture change needed to embed community empowerment in all corners of the public sector. It is happening, but it will take time. Legislation is a start. It sends a clear message to public authorities about how we expect them to act, and will give communities confidence that they have the right to have their proposals taken seriously. Thank you, Convener.
Thank you very much, Minister, and we'll move to some questions from members. Graeme Simpson to start the questioning.
Thank you. Well, thanks for coming again, Minister. We've taken evidence from various people expressing the fear that local authorities in particular could take different approaches to asset transfer and could, if they were so minded, my phrase, wriggle out of it under your legislation. How can you ensure a consistency of approach?
One of the things which we always do in these regards, and I'm sure, Convener, that this committee will scrutinise what happens as the Community Empowerment Act is rolled out, we'll look closely at what is happening across the country. We already have fairly good examples of local authorities who are already embracing aspects of the Community Empowerment Act without it being in force. There may be a reticence in some places to go along with all of this, and I talked about people. And we kind of legislate for people. There may be some folk out there that think that this is not the right thing to do. What we will do is scrutinise very closely what is going on across the country. I've talked about the rights of appeal to Scottish ministers, if that's required. We'll look closely at how many folk have to resort to an appeal process to get what they want. And I would hope that, like myself, that the committee itself will keep a very close eye, scrutinise, see if there's any areas that need to be tightened up. But I want to look at this from the positive aspects, because I think that as we see the rollout of all of this, that people across the country will be enthused by it. I hope that politicians locally will also be enthused by it. And I'm quite sure that very quickly we'll see the benefits of people taking control, not only of assets, but also in being involved in shaping services.
Okay.
Follow up on that?
Yeah. I asked a question last week. I think we can all see the benefits of this. But where a community body takes over an asset, there is obviously a risk that it might fail. So what do you think will happen if it fails? What would then happen to that asset?
We're embarking on a new journey here. And, you know, one of the things which has concerned folk in the past is how we treat failure. And, you know, there will be cases, without a doubt here, where things don't succeed. And I've asked the Accounts Commission in a recent meeting with them that they and Audit Scotland take cognizance of the fact that this is new work. We have got people taking control of things for the first time and to take account of failure. I think what we have got to do is to look at these occasions where that happens, and hopefully it won't be a lot, and see how local authorities and others react to that situation. Now, I would hope that what we would see is a level of cooperation to ensure that folk are supported to the utmost. This committee has heard me before talking about community capacity building. They also know that I hate the term, but I can't think of anything else. And hopefully what we can do is, rather than see failures, to put in the help required to get folk through. But where there are failures, obviously in the contracts that are drawn up, we will have to see what can be done to the asset if there is a failure in that regard. And I would expect local authorities and other public bodies to make sure that there's accountability in that regard. I may bring in some of the civil servants here. Ian? Jean, sorry, I beg your pardon.
There is provision in the guidance. We've looked at the issues about how relevant authorities can protect their investment if things go wrong, and there is advice in there about making provision for whether the asset should come back to the authority that previously owned it, how they might get money back if they've given a discount on it, so that is something there is guidance on.
Stand on that a bit. Yeah, what is that guidance?
It's something that is up to the relevant authority to decide what's appropriate in the circumstances. Obviously, if a community body comes in and they are paying full market value and the authority is not really kind of giving them any discount on it, then they're just the same as any other buyer. It's theirs. If they fail, it gets sold. Because of the forms of organisation that they have to take to be eligible to do asset transfer, they have to have provision in their constitution that says what happens to any remaining assets if they fail after all liabilities are cleared. They may end up having to sell the property to fulfil debts. But you can put something in the contract either to say if this body folds, that property comes back to the organisation that it was bought from. You can put something to say if it doesn't deliver the benefits that were expected and there was a discount, they have to pay back the discount to the relevant authority. So there's a range of measures that they can use as appropriate in different circumstances.
Can I also point out, Convener, that the guidance itself in this regard highlights that any such arrangements in terms of the payback should be proportionate and not restrict the community body's ability to develop their activities. So there are a range of things within the guidance around about this.
Okay, thank you. Graham Simpson, to follow up on any of that?
That'll do for now, thanks.
Now, can we stay with asset transfers? Any number of members have indicated they wish to speak, but can we stick with asset transfers? Andrew Whiteman.
Thank you very much, Convener. Welcome, Minister. Thanks for coming along this morning. I just want to ask you a question about what are inelegantly called ALIOs, arm's length external organisations. You've helpfully provided a letter to the committee about them, and I understand why these bodies are not included on the face of the Act, but can be added by ministerial order. I have constituents who are extremely keen to go on the 23rd of January with assets that are owned by EDI Group, which is wholly owned by CEC Holdings Limited, which is wholly owned by the City of Edinburgh Council. What would be the procedure to invite you to add a group like EDI Group to the list of relevant authorities?
One of the things which I explained in my letter is around about a robust legal definition of an ALIO, which the Accounts Commission is going to look at. I think that it is important that we get the definition of ALIO right in that regard. And it's something with which the predecessor committee wrestled with as well. But many of the assets that we're talking about, although they may be administered by an ALIO, may be wholly in the ownership of the local authority itself. So I think that, you know, just because the ALIO's name is over the door of a building, it doesn't mean to say that that is not owned by the public body itself. And obviously, I think that that is a matter of negotiation between the public body, in this case, the council and the community organisation, to see if that asset could be transferred. The difficulty in all of this, of course, convener, is that ALIOs come in many legal forms. Developing and securing agreement to robust and precise legal definitions of ALIOs would be a major undertaking. And as I say, Audit Scotland will be doing more work on ALIOs in 2017-18, and we hope that that will inform further developments. And if you don't mind, I'll take in Jean again to add to that.
Could I just
clarify though, my question is not about the definition of ALIOs.
One second. Sorry, Mr. Whiteman, just want to make sure if Jean wants to add anything first.
No.
Okay, in you come.
Yes, just to clarify, my question is not about the definition of ALIOs. My question is about a relevant authority that meets the criteria of Section 78, which EDI Group does. It is a company wholly owned by one or more relevant authorities, or actually, in fact, it's owned by other companies that are wholly owned by the relevant authority. In other words, it meets the criteria in Section 78. There's no question about that in my mind. There's no need for complex definitions. It meets the statutory criteria. I'm asking you what the process would be for anyone, a member of the public, an MSP, City of Edinburgh Council, anybody, to persuade you to put EDI Group or any similar group that meets the requirements of Section 78 in the schedule of the Act?
Okay. Well, I think at this moment, designating individual ALIOs as relevant authorities might not be effective, as there's nothing to stop the local authority creating a new body instead, for example. Existing definitions of ALIOs could include private or community organisations who are mainly funded by a local authority, or companies owned by other public bodies, including Scottish ministers. Now, I think that there is work to be done in terms of the definition of ALIOs. And I think that, you know, we can come back again and look at all of this. However, I would go back to my original point that in some cases, just because the ALIO's name is over the door of a building, that building may be wholly owned by the council and should not necessarily limit the possibility of asset transfer, as far as I'm concerned.
Mr. Whiteman?
I'm aware of that. I'm talking about property that the title deeds are in the name of, in this case, and I don't want to, you know, focus on one case, but this particular case in my constituency, owned by EDI Group. EDI Group meets the definitions of a relevant authority that could be nominated, could be put on the schedule by ministers. I'm just asking, what is the process by which anyone who wishes to see such a relevant authority put on the schedule, what is the process by which they invite you, persuade you, make the case? What's the process for you responding?
Well, Minister, just before you answer that, because I think we'd all like to be clear, I thought the additional powers in secondary legislation that you would have to come back and add by addition relevant authorities to be on the schedule would be done in the round. I didn't think it was one potential ALIO would be petitioned upon. I thought you would look at the matter in the round and look at ALIOs more generally and take the powers, or would it be one individual ALIO? I suppose that's what I would want clarity on, Mr. White. I just want to check that.
We would have to look at ALIOs in the round. I'll bring in Jean and then I'll add comment myself.
The legislation does allow for individual bodies to be named, it has to be done through a statutory instrument, as we are doing with Historic Environment Scotland. But in general, we don't name non-statutory bodies in legislation because they can just go and change themselves. If we're concerned that authorities are trying to use ALIOs as a way of avoiding asset transfer, naming one wouldn't stop them doing that.
And that's what I was trying to get across in my previous answer to Mr. Whiteman, convener. I think, you know, we should allow Audit Scotland to deal with the aspects of the work about the definition and look to adding in other designated bodies at a later date.
Okay. Andy Whiteman, do you want to follow up on some of that?
Okay, well, we have a relevant authority here. It meets the requirements of Section 78. I'm just wanting to know how that process is done. Anyway, I'll move on. I have one other question.
Is it an asset transfer?
It's not an asset transfer.
Right. Okay. Does any other member of any question in relation to asset transfer? Alexander Stewart.
Thank you, Minister. I think there's a real appetite and there's a real enthusiasm across many local authorities for this to work. And we've seen that. And within my own council area, Perth and Kinross, where we've had capacity workers and trying to engage in doing all of that. And I've also seen in my own council area where an ALIO has been re-evolved to try and become some other different organisation to try and become part of what you're trying to achieve. My concern is that we need to ensure that there's no avoidance, and that's already been touched on this morning. If there's an attempt from a council to try and deal with moving it into a new role or moving it into a new name or creating a new body that gives them an avoidance process. And what scrutiny and what governance would we have in place to ensure that if we thought that was being processed, how we would manage to capture that as we go forward?
Okay. Avoidance itself, I think, would not be particularly beneficial to the local authority, and you know that we have the right of appeal to Scottish ministers. I think that we should look at this in a positive light rather than always concentrate on the negative, because thus far, without having all aspects of this Act in place, we've already seen some very good work going on right across the country. And I think it would be particularly daft politicians in local authority areas if they were going to put major blockages in place to allow people to take over an asset if they are capable of doing so, when those folks can see what is happening in other parts of the country. However, you know, we do sometimes get situations whereby illogicality does take place. And that's why I think it's incumbent on all of us to make sure that the Act is working appropriately in every part of the country. And I would reiterate again, you know, one of the things which is in place is the appeals to Scottish ministers. And that obviously is something that I think that those folks who may want to block should be somewhat wary of. And I'll bring in Jean as well, please, convener.
Don't have anything to add to that.
It's just in case I miss anything, convener.
You seem to have covered it all, because Ms. Wood doesn't have anything to add. Just let me just make sure. Do you want to come back in there, Alexander?
I acknowledge what you're saying, and I do believe that there is a real opportunity here. But when I was taking evidence previously, Minister, I talked about organisations in two different situations where one had found it very successful and had found it a great opportunity and everything had gone right. And they'd managed to transfer the asset, and it was a win-win situation for everybody. But in a very similar situation in another area, it had gone all wrong. And it was they weren't too different in what they were trying to achieve.
Sure.
But as I say, one group felt that they had achieved it miraculously and everything had gone well, and one group was left with a bad taste in their mouth about how this had to go through so many loops and so many things, and it didn't work at the end for them. So they were left being disappointed from that massive enthusiasm that had been created to then being disappointed and disillusioned by the whole process because it hadn't worked.
Sure. Convener, these things have happened without the Act being in place, and I could give examples of good and bad too. I'll give an example without naming an organisation, but a transfer of a piece of land which had been derelict for a long while took over 4 years in one place to get the legal agreement. And that's a little bit of risk aversity in some regards, because the local authority obviously felt that they had a requirement to protect that asset, for what I don't know in these circumstances. But, you know, the Act itself gives them, you know, the ability, the backup to proceed with greater speed, and gets rid of the risk aversity that exists in certain places but not in others. So, you know, I think we can pick the good and the bad examples of what has gone on thus far. We can certainly see that some local authorities have made major movement in this area without the legislation being in place, where others have not. I think that the legislation itself gives them the backup, takes out the risk adversity, and hopefully will allow them to get on with the job so that people can have positive experiences rather than some of the negativity that has happened because there's been a certain amount of risk adversity.
Thank you, Convener.
Just on asset transfer, Minister, we heard suggestions that one of the things a public body could potentially do would be when a request comes in for asset transfer is an asset they've sat on and done nothing with for a long period of time, and they suddenly move to dispose of it. And the suggestion was made that there should be a freezing of assets at a certain point within the process to stop public bodies doing that. How would you respond to calls for that to be brought into the legislation?
Well, I think that this issue, if I remember your official report rightly, was raised with a committee by Ian Cook from DTAS. And he said that the guidance should be more robust in this regard, since a community body has to put in a lot of effort to prepare business cases while the property could be sold in the meantime. This, Convener, is not really a matter for guidance or the regulations. It is set out in the Act, Section 92, where the submission of a formal request is the only clear starting point available for the legislation. The approach suggested would be similar to community right to buy, where a community body registers interest in the land, after which the owner cannot sell it to anyone else until a decision has been made on the community's proposals.
So you're content the balance is right within the Act in relation to that?
I think that the balance is right, Convener.
Okay. Also in relation to that, we heard, I think it was from Bruce Kylo from SPT, who mentioned one of the aspects that Shrackley Passenger Transport, other public bodies may have, is a land bank or assets out there that may form part of a future strategic interest for that public organisation, and that might be a reason to have to turn down or refuse an otherwise reasonable request for an asset transfer. I'm just wondering, is there anything in the legislation or guidance that points out how long something could be sitting in a local development plan for where nothing's actually happened to it? So you could have land designated for an airport rail link, or you could have it designated for a tram, or you could have it designated for housing, but it's been sitting fallow for 10, 15, 20, 30 years and a community wishes to access it. At what point would it be reasonable to say, well, that may be your aspiration, but it's been your aspiration for the last 10, 15, 20 years, the community now wishes. Should there be a limit upon that strategic approach? Perhaps those are bad examples, Minister, but you could imagine a public body citing a strategic reason for not giving land, which could just be a block to... I'm not suggesting SPT were suggesting that, but that could be a downside to that approach.
I think if something is set aside for a strategic reason, and we all know that some major development take a fair while to come to fruition, I think that is a good reason for saying, you know, this is something that we cannot allow a transfer of. I think common sense has to apply in some of these regards, because, you know, if we look at a rail line, as you've suggested, that in itself, as I say, may take that 10, 20 years. If you look at some major projects that have taken place in Scotland, some of which are taking place now, you know, it has been a fair while, if not decades in some cases, before that has proceeded. And I think it would be incumbent of a local authority or other public body to look at what the needs are for delivering that project. And in these cases, you know, I think it would be fair and justifiable if they were saying that this was part of that strategy to build whatever it may be, that they refuse in this case. And I'll take in Jean.
Jean Woody.
Absolutely, yeah. There are certain areas that you can see will be needed in the long term. Of course, I would mention is that there's some excellent guidance now on what's known as meanwhile use. So an authority can say, well, we know we need to keep this, but we're not going to be doing anything with it in the next 5 years. And they can allow, for example, community gardening. I mean, obviously, it would be temporary use. But there are things that can be done so that it just doesn't lie there looking ugly for all that time. I've forgotten the organisation that does that guidance, but there's some excellent guidance on that.
Thank you very much. We'll move on from asset transfer. Ruth Maguire.
Good morning, Minister.
Good morning.
I'd like to hear your thoughts on participation requests. The evidence that we've taken from organisations has all been pretty positive, and you mentioned yourself that there's good work already going on. One of the concerns about the participation request aspect of it was the impact that it might have on already good relationships that public bodies have with their communities if things are formalised. I'd just like to hear your thoughts on that.
I think if there are already good relationships between bodies and public authorities, then there's probably very little need for those community organisations to use participation requests. Again, we can already see across the country local authorities that are taking cognizance of the views of communities when it comes to the shaping of services. Now, I would say that in these places who are already carrying out all of that work, that it would be rare for participation requests to be used. I think the likelihood is that participation requests would be where there are not so good relationships and where communities and community groups think that they're being ignored by the public body when it comes to the shaping of services. And my hope, and sometimes our hopes become reality and sometimes they don't, but my hope would be that there is not a real use of participation requests, because I hope that that this legislation will change the attitude of public bodies to ensure that the level of consultation and engagement with communities and community groups at the beginning of the shaping of a service gets rid of the requirement for the use of participation requests. We already see some very good practice in terms of engagement. I hope that that continues. I hope that we don't see a huge amount of usage of participation requests. And I think where there are already good relationships, where communities are already fully involved in the shaping of services, I can't see there being any tensions created with this new legislation at all.
How do we go about educating everyone about that then? What can the Scottish Government do to make sure that people know that they are really that sort of fallback thing, that's not the standard way that we want to engage? And just as a wee follow-up, do you think that the participation request process might be helpful where there's conflict within communities about what should be used if there's perhaps two different communities of interest, maybe, or if something stretches across localities, that process could be used to help resolve that.
In terms of where there is already good engagement and good examples, I'm probably going to bore the committee by saying something that I say very regularly. I'm extremely keen to ensure that best practice is exported right across Scotland. We have got many bodies involved in this sphere who can help us in terms of getting the message across of where good practice is taking place and trying to persuade and cajole others to follow suit. Organisations, for example, like DTAS, who can help us in this regard. Where there are conflicting views within communities themselves about the way forward or how a service should be delivered, again, I think that rather than relying on participation requests, which in those kind of circumstances may cause some difficulty, the first objective there, if I was in that situation representing those communities, would be to try and get the different opinions round the table and see if there is common ground to be found there to actually garner where there is agreement, what can be done in terms of moving forward in the agreement first of all, and then trying to work through the maybe individual bits and pieces of conflict that exists. Okay.
Thank you. Yeah, that's helpful. Thank you.
Okay. Now, before the end of this evidence session, we will come back and mop up some final questions and asset transfer, but we'll continue on some other themes at the moment. Andy Whiteman.
Thank you, Convener. I just a brief question about, it's not in relation to the existing SSIs, but in relation to the Act itself. Do you have any plans to bring Part 8 on common good registers into force soon? Have you got a timetable for that?
I'll take in Jean first of all, Convener.
Jean Woody.
There's work ongoing to develop the guidance that's needed to bring that into force. I don't know of a date at the moment.
Okay. Anyone want to add anything before we come back to Mr. Whiteman?
What I would say to Mr. Whiteman is I'll look at that very closely and I'll write back to the committee. Okay. One of the things, Convener, which the committee is probably very well aware of is that during the course of the scrutiny of the bill, I took a very keen interest on the common good aspects of this because of difficulties that I faced in my past in determining whether or not land was held in the Common Good Fund in Aberdeen or not. I think that we're moving forward in this regard, but I will write back to the committee to give more detail and timescales for the committee and Mr. Whiteman.
Okay. Anything else, Mr. Whiteman, you want to add? Okay, Kenneth Gibson.
Thank you very much. Apologies for coming in late at the start of the session. I'm suffering from a bit of a flu this morning, I'm afraid. So I'll ask my colleagues not to get too close. Anyway, it's just regarding
you can
asset.
See being supportive of you there, Mr. Gibson.
Indeed, I like the way they just leapt away. Yes, asset transfer I think is very much desirable when the community is in favour of it, and I think we would all like to remove as many barriers as possible to that actually happening. But I want to ask you about the converse. A few years ago in North Ayrshire we had an issue whereby communities were effectively told that they were going to have to take over community assets or the assets would simply be closed due to a removal of local authority funding. Now, there was a bit of an outcry about that and at the end that did not actually take place, but there was a lot of anxiety in communities because not every community wants to run its asset, quite frankly. A lot of people are quite happy to volunteer in a local community facility, but they don't necessarily want to have to go through all the kind of hassle of insuring it and maintaining it and et cetera, et cetera. So how do we ensure that while the Act allows communities who want to take over assets to do so, that at the same time it's not used as an excuse by public bodies to effectively dump, for want of a better word, unwanted assets onto community organisations who may not have the capacity or the desire to actually take over and run those?
Minister.
Convener, I would be very unhappy if anyone was to use this Act to try and foist assets on to communities. Very unhappy indeed. This Community Empowerment Act is to allow those folks who want to, take on these assets to do so. Now, it may well be that in the future we will see many more communities gain the capacity, and it may well be that in the future we will see many more communities, some of whom at this moment don't feel that they can take on an asset, will move to do so. But I would be extremely annoyed if this Act was used by any public body to try and foist assets onto communities that don't want to take control of those assets.
Mr. Gibson?
Yeah, thanks very much for that. I mean, it's just wondering if the Scottish Government, if there would be any redress in such for communities in such a situation. I'm just thinking of the fact that a public body might just say, you know, we want this is costing us X amount a year. But we'll just tell the community it's either closing or they take it over, and basically putting a shotgun to the heads of local community organisations. That's really the kind of worry I might have.
Local authorities will, always have the ability to look at their estate and the assets that they have. And it may well be that a local authority chooses to close an asset. We know that this happens on a fairly regular basis, sometimes with the approval of the community, sometimes not. But what I would not want is a situation that Mr. Gibson is describing. If a local authority chooses to close an asset, to dispose of an asset, obviously there should be consultation with the community about that. But what I would be unhappy about would be that situation that Mr. Gibson describes, whereby the gun is put to somebody's head and say, take it over or close. There should be engagement about closure. There should be alternatives given to communities, suggested alternatives about where services that are maybe delivered in those buildings can be delivered elsewhere, you know. But this act is about empowering communities, not about foisting assets on people.
Thank you, Mr. Gibson. Can I ask one additional point? I think Mr. Gibson had a really good line of questioning. So in my constituency, a local community centre run by Glasgow Life and Alio was closed in Coder. But through work with the local authority, the land was transferred to local housing association. There's now a new community centre there that's been very successful, £1.2 million of Scottish Government money to help fund that. But following Mr. Gibson's line of questioning, that was a liability for the local authority or the ALIO. It was costing significant amounts of cash to staff it, to repair it. It was a rundown liability. So there's been a cash saving there to the local authority. Is there any guidance at all within the Act or the statute instruments in relation to when community groups take on assets like that, in this case it was a housing association to be fair, whether that should come with a dowry? Because there will be a significant financial saving to a public body or a local authority, as well as a cash receipt.
Jean, and then I'll come in.
There's nothing specific in the guidance about that. There's not a great deal of specific advice on what should be done in terms of funding, because obviously the authority may be looking for that saving to use for other services somewhere else. But certainly if they are getting a benefit from giving it over to the community, if they can support the community in some way with cash or with making a contract for services, that's always a good thing to do to support them to make a success of that asset.
Minister?
Yeah, beyond that, you know, it's up to each public body to look at what takes place as part of the transfer. But, you know, Convener, and you've kind of described it yourself in terms of the example that you gave. In some cases, the transfer of the asset opens up the opportunity for the community to tap in to other pots of funding. And, you know, we've seen that a fair bit already without the Act being in place. And the situation that you describe sounds like the community itself has managed to access funding from the Scottish Government. This is not an example that I'm aware of off the top of my head. But we all know that in other places, the opportunity for funding from lottery, which wouldn't have necessarily been available from the local authority, or other organisations or trusts often come into play when that transfer takes place.
Okay, that's helpful. I was merely pointing out when there was a success story in relation to all the partners getting together. I was just wondering whether there was any guidance around that, but that was the reason for following up Mr. Gibson's line of questioning. Can I check with members, are there any additional questions at this point? Okay, there have been none. Can I thank you for your evidence, agenda item 2, and can I move to agenda item 3, which is still on subordinate legislation. And for this item, the committee will formally consider motion S5M02700, calling on the Local Government Communities Committee to recommend that the Parliament approve the draft asset transfer request, designation of relevant authority, Scotland Order 2017. There's now a debate where only the Minister and members may speak. Can I ask whether or not anyone wishes to move it first? I just check. Okay, before we move to the debate, I'm just checking, Minister, I get the order right here. Can I ask you to move the motion?
I formally move the motion, Convener.
Okay, now would be the opportunity for a debate. Do any members wish to participate in a debate at this point? Mr. Whiteman.
Yes, thank you. This is a very short order designating a new relevant authority. I hope future orders can be as expeditiously granted and passed.
Thank you, Mr. Whiteman. Any other members wish to make any comments at this point? Excellent. We do like brevity from time to time. Minister, the shortest of debates, but would you wish to sum up as part of that debate?
I'm quite happy, Convener, to leave it as is. As you well know, I've got a great interest in this. I hope that the committee itself will continue to scrutinise all of this to the same degree as the predecessor committee, and I'm happy to come here at any point to talk about community empowerment further.
I am sure we will have you back, Minister. Thank you very much for those words. So the question is that motion S5M02700 in the name of the Minister for Parliamentary Business be approved. Are we all agreed?
Agreed.
Okay. We are agreed. And the committee will report on the outcome of this instrument in due course. We now move to agenda item 4, which is still with subordinate legislation. And I will now list through a whole series of negative instruments. The committee will consider the following negative instruments: the Asset Transfer Request Procedure, Scotland Regulation 2016, SSI 2016-357, the Asset Transfer Request Review Procedure, Scotland Regulation 2016, SSI 2016-358, the Asset Transfer Request Appeal, Scotland Regulation 2016, SSI 2016-359, the Asset Transfer Request Appeal for No Contract Concluded, Scotland Regulations 2016, SSI 2016-360, the Asset Transfer Request Designation of Community Transfer Body, Scotland Order 2016, SSI 2016-361, the Community Empowerment Registers of Land, Scotland Regulations 2016, SSI 2016-362, and if you're still following me, anyone who's listening, the Community Planning Locality Planning, Scotland Regulations 2016, SSI 2016-364. I've put those on the record. I now want to point out that in relation to a number of these negative instruments, the Delegated Powers and Law Reform Committee reported on a number of the negative instruments due to technical errors or lack of clarity, and the Scottish Government has agreed to bring forward some amending instruments where required. These errors do not affect the policy being implemented by the instruments. We want to put that on the public record this morning. These instruments are laid under the negative procedure, which means that their provisions will come into force unless the Parliament votes on a motion to annul the instruments. No motion to annul has been laid, and can I invite members to make any comments in the instruments that I have just listed through there? Okay, there have been no comments. Should I ask the committee, whether they agree that they do not wish to make any recommendations in relation to these instruments. Are we agreed?
Agreed.
Okay. Thank you very much. That ends that section of evidence. Thank you very much, Minister.
Thank you, Convener. Thank you, Committee.
And we suspend briefly. Good morning, everyone, and welcome back to Local Government Communities Committee. We now move to Agenda Item 5, Payment to Returning Officers in Scotland. And rarely for our committee, we're slightly ahead of schedule, which is all good. The committee will take evidence from a number of witnesses to explore the purpose and appropriateness of providing payments for or fees to returning officers for the conduct of elections in Scotland. And can I welcome this morning Malcolm Burr, Chair, Solace Scotland, Mary Pitcaithley, Convener, Electoral Management Board for Scotland, and Mary O'Donnell, Chief Executive, Glasgow City Council, Andy Hunter, Chair, Scotland and Northern Ireland Branch, Association of Electoral Administrators, and Elsa Irvine, Director of Electoral Administration and Guidance, Electoral Commission Scotland. Can I thank you all for your attendance this morning. Well, we were doing a short focused inquiry into payments for returning officers for elections, and we're going to move straight to questions. Thank you for indicating that you don't wish to make any opening statements. There obviously has been a degree of public concern over the level of payments of returning officers, and we've had some very helpful evidence for a number of you giving evidence today in relation to the purpose for that, the separation of powers and legal responsibilities between jobs as local authority chief executives and as returning officers, and that's all very clear there. But I do know that Mr. Hunter said within his submission that any remuneration for any position should be regularly reviewed and evaluated, and that of returning officers should also be the case. I wonder if we can start off with a very general question, asking the witnesses whether you appreciate why there's public concern in relation to the level of payments, and do you agree with Mr. Hunter that now might be a good time to review those payments? Who'd like to start in relation to that?
Perhaps I could start, Chairman, and thank you for your welcome. Public concern is an interesting concept with elections, because 92% of the public, I think, believe elections are well run, and certainly it hasn't crossed the desk of the organisation which I represent that there is significant public concern about the amounts received by returning officers. These amounts vary, of course, considerably from 2,500 for single smaller rural constituencies to higher figures. But I think, without getting into the complexity of the role and all that kind of material which we may come on to, I think we would say that it is a system which has been in place for some time. It has not been a matter of public report or concern for many, many years. Any system, I think, benefits from review. There are certain aspects of it, for example, the expectation that deputy returning officers who play a key role in the delivery of elections are remunerated from the returning officer's fee, as it were, of our charity, is a very strange and somewhat antediluvian way of looking at remuneration of public servants. And any system, I think, would benefit from review periodically. This system has not been reviewed for some time, and certainly Solace would certainly be very happy to contribute to such a review.
Okay, who else would like to go next in relation to that? Elsa Irvine.
Yeah, I mean, I think from the Electoral Commission perspective, obviously we're very concerned about making sure that there is public confidence in our democratic process. As Malcolm said, that does come through strongly. There are high levels of satisfaction with the service that is delivered, which we shouldn't take for granted and we can't be complacent about. That is down to a considerable amount of hard work. But I think, having said that, I think it's not unreasonable that there would want to be a review of the fees that are set to make sure that public confidence can be maintained, and the Commission would be more than happy to be involved and to support that work.
And Mr. Burr didn't think there was any concern in relation to it. Do you think there's concern? Or people have to actually know about the payments to have concern, I suppose. But my post bag is, when people do know about the payments, there are concerns raised, and that's not incidentally undermining the role of what we think is an exceptional performance in the running of elections in Scotland. There can still be public concern. So, Ms. Irvine, it's good that you think that this would be a good time to review it, but do you understand that there's public concern?
I think it's not something that has been raised with us as an electoral commission in terms of the inquiries that we're receiving. We are not seeing evidence that this is a widespread issue. However, if that is an issue, and I think it's not unreasonable to look at this to make sure that public confidence can be maintained. Yes, we have high levels. We don't know entirely what sits behind that. And if there are concerns, then I think now is the time to look at it.
Okay. Mary Pitcaithley.
Yes, as members will be aware, I frequently refer to the fact that the Electoral Management Board works on the basis of trying to do everything to build the confidence of electors in the integrity of our system. I can't say that anyone has raised with me any issue specifically about fees. I do think the issue of fees is actually quite well known. I think there's been quite a lot of media coverage about that. It's not something that people raise with me. They have concerns about lots of issues to do with elections, but not specifically this one. However, if members are receiving those sorts of concerns, you're quite right to instigate some sort of discussion about that, which is what you're doing. And I think we'd be quite happy to participate in that process.
Okay, thank you. Anne-Marie O'Donnell. Yeah.
Thank you, Minister. I think the last thing returning officers want is for the integrity of the election process to be undermined. All local authorities have job evaluation schemes that we use to assess the worth for the work undertaken by staff. And given the issue that we're discussing today, I think all returning officers through SOLAS and EMB would be happy to participate in a review of the evaluation of the role of returning officers.
Okay, thank you. Mr. Hunter, I should probably came to you first, as I plucked out one sentence from your evidence. No. Mr. Hunter, do you want to add anything?
Not in particular. I concur with everything that's been said. Like all things, we're spending public money. There should always be confidence that that's done appropriately. So that's part of the reason it's in there. But part of the issue, I think, is also about understanding in the public about what the role is. It's not widely known necessarily right across the board, and I think maybe perhaps some of that's why some of the inquiries you do receive around the payments are raised. And again, that's part of the transparency and confidence in the system that's understood out in the public domain as well.
Okay, that's helpful. And I think other members will want to follow up in relation to the appropriateness and remuneration of the payments. But one of the things we were trying to explore at an earlier evidence session was, well, there are only so many hours in a day. There's elections pretty much every year, sometimes twice a year. The job of a local authority chief executive is a pretty demanding one. I know MSPs, myself included, correspond with local authority chief executives. It's a very challenging and significant job. So looking at Mary Pitcaithley's submission, you talk about a complex and extensive work programme that is the responsibility of the returning officer, separate from chief executive duties, to undertake. And I, for brevity, I'll only give part of this list. Talk about a communications programme, the publication of all relevant statutory notices, the nomination process, the production, dispatch and verification of postal votes, the identification, booking and equipping of polling stations, the recruitment, appointment, training, remuneration of presiding officers, polling clerks and other polling staff, securing a suitable count venue and its operational setup, including cabling and media. I'll stop. There are five other bullet points listed there for brevity. But if I then go to the next section in your submission, you talk about management responsibilities for returning officers as well, which includes commanding the required staff and resources to deliver a well-run election, drawing in the necessary support skills and expertise from across the local authority council, overseeing the planning, project management and risk management of the election, incorporating lessons learnt from previous polls, identifying any actions necessary to mitigate any issues arising. And I'll stop there. There are four others on that list. I suppose what I'm trying to say is, given the demands of a local authority chief executive, given that these are payments specific to being a returning officer and the independence of that, something's got to give from the day job, surely. So how, Mary Pitcaithley, how do local authority chief executives do the day job, which they're pretty well paid for in the first place, and do all this as well where there's additional payments?
Yes, it is a complex and demanding day job, but when the requirements that are placed upon us by the returning officer duty come into play, and that's by no means just in the few weeks immediately prior to an election, it's year round we have responsibilities. But when those requirements have to be covered, then they are covered. Now, in my own case, and I can only talk for me, but in my own case, that would normally mean working longer hours. So if I normally try to manage my work in a 60 or 70 hour week, I would just work longer for the required period of time. So I would give up my Saturday or my Sunday or whatever that I would normally maybe try to protect to give me some work-life balance. I'm not looking for sympathy in all of this. I would hesitate. I absolutely emphasise. It is demanding. And there is no doubt at all that, you know, the responsibilities and the accountabilities that come with the returning officer job do add to the demands on us. But we do have people who work with us on this. We're not suggesting for a minute that every single task that you've highlighted is carried out by ourselves with no support. That's absolutely not the case. I'm very well supported in my authority by people who are either doing the work because it is their day job, that's the day job that we employ them for, or because it's, as with me, something additional to the day job, and that we would expect them to be remunerated for that as well. Now, normally that remuneration would come from the maximum recoverable allowance, which is what Parliament allocates to each of us for running elections. That could be in the basis of additional responsibility payments, overtime, or a particular fee that would come from the returning officer as well. So there are all sorts of ways in which we would make sure that the staff who do some of these day-to-day tasks are properly remunerated. I was certainly conscious from your last evidence session, Minister, that, you know, there was some suggestion that we were, if you like, looking after ourselves and not taking care of the people who work for us. And I would suggest that that's not the case. I am very anxious that the people who are involved in the elections at every level, from those who work in the polling stations for a 15-hour day, from those who work in the counts, often overnight, are properly remunerated, and that goes right through the entire process.
I'm tempted not to correct any of the witnesses. I love the idea of being called Minister, but...
Oh, sorry! Apologies.
I'm a merely humble backbencher. Convener or Bob will suffice, I can assure you, but thank you for that. Before we take other witnesses in, there are only so many hours in a day. Last time I checked, there are only 7 days in a week. I think lots of people sit around this table know what it's like, Saturdays and Sunday working, and long hours. You could say that's the gig we signed up for, but there's no additional monies there, nor should we. We're well paid for our job, quite frankly. I do believe that local chief executives are very, very well paid for their job. I get that there's additional responsibilities there. I'm merely pointing out, surely something has to give. There must be some part of the local authority day job that gets delegated to other officials.
I wouldn't find that to be my experience at all, Convener. We carry on with our day job. We add these additional responsibilities to that and the additional tasks that have to be done. But I'm not... I can't recall a situation where I've had a significant part of the day job has had to be delegated to someone else.
But delegation does happen more often during election time.
You know, that's genuinely not my experience. I don't have a whole team of people who work for me to whom I can delegate tasks, but I certainly don't delegate any more than I normally would, which would be a reasonable process of delegation of responsibilities of the day job. But I don't find myself having to do that more often in the run-up to an election, no. I don't know if my colleagues want to add anything to that.
I'm curious to know from our other witnesses. I just do find it, and I totally take it face value, Ms. McCaithley, what you're saying, absolutely, but I find it hard to come to terms with the fact that all these additional duties that I read out and nothing gives in the day job that everyone's well paid for. I commend you that that's the case. What's the experience of others around the table? Anne-Marie O'Donnell.
I would agree with Mary. I'm a committed chief executive and I'm also a committed returning officer. I have one officer within Glasgow City Council who has election within his title, my election coordinator. I also have, you may be familiar with him, I have a number of colleagues who step into election roles in the preparation to assist me in the running of the election, as Mary's highlighted. But I don't delegate any of my chief executive role to anyone. That is my role and my role alone in my organisation. And without looking for any form of sympathy, what does go, and maybe MSPs around the table will experience this themselves, is there's personal sacrifices that you have to give in the run-up, in the preparation for elections, particularly if there's more than one, if you take this year in context. It's those are the sacrifices that a returning officer, and personally, I give to ensure that the elections that I'm responsible for are run with transparency, robustness and full integrity.
So is the delegation that happens more delegation of some of the responsibility, the ultimate legal responsibility always sits with yourselves as returning officers, but is the delegation of some of that work, I assume, goes to officials? I mean, it's Mr. Miller, I think you might have been referring to.
Yes, Mr. Miller's my election coordinator, but if I can reflect in the Scottish parliamentary elections in May of this year, we have a significant electorate in Glasgow across 8 constituencies. So I have to plan the training for my poll staff, who number around 1,100. So I have a number of staff who carry out training on my behalf, but it's training that I've prepared and it's training that I attend. But I can't be in 7 training rooms at the same time every night over 6 nights. So I have staff who will conduct the training on my behalf, but it's training that I've prepared. I have, with David, a number of constituency managers who help me identify appropriate polling stations. So I have 501 polling stations across 202 polling places. Now that's a significant exercise that I couldn't undertake on my own. So this is where you start to build your election team in the planning for elections, ensuring you're using the right resources in the right areas to identify what needs to be put in place to ensure you deliver that election on the day with precision accuracy.
Does anyone else want to add anything to that before we move on? Okay, I know, Mr. Shute, I'm going to bring you in a second, but can I just check that there was media reports that some returning officers give monies to charity, or they pass some of the monies down to other staff. I'm not seeking to compel you to say what you do. There's an appropriateness in what you do or don't want to share, but I don't know if you want to make any comments in relation to that.
I think I'd be like most people. I would not want to say anything about my charity giving in public. It's not something you do to get some sort of public kudos. But I certainly would normally share my fee with depute returning officers who work for me.
Okay. Any other comments in relation to that?
That would be my position too, Chairman. I have on occasion shared the fee with depute returning officers.
Okay. Anne-Marie O'Donnell.
I think all members around the table will appreciate that I receive the highest fee as returning officer in Scotland. And like Mary and Malcolm, I've been asked that question on a number of occasions, and I've always responded on the basis that I wouldn't want to disclose what I do with my fee, but what I would advise committee is that a number of people and organisations do benefit from the returning officer fee.
Okay. Thank you. Mr. Shute, and anyone else make any additional comments in relation to this? Mr. Hunter?
Obviously, I'm not a returning officer, yeah, so I can't answer directly. But in terms of any of the fees that are delegated down to the deputy returning officer, these are clearly marked, and the accounts have to be returned by returning officers. So they are open. That part of it, the user fee in that way, is made public, or can be made public.
Okay. Thank you very much. Alexander Stewart.
Can I just carry on from some of the conversations and questions we've had from the convener? In a local authority, or in some local authorities, you have a chief executive. You then have deputy chief executives in some local authorities. Not all, but you have them in some. And in some of those cases, then the presiding officer of a local authority is the chief executive. The deputies can sometimes be the assistant chief executive, whatever they call themselves. They get the role of being the deputy to the chief executive. They then sometimes get the role of being the deputy to the returning officer. You then have, in some authorities, you have a director of democratic services. You would then have an election team. The election team are employed on Monday to Friday basis to manage elections. I know this all happens in my relatively small council in Perth and Kinross. I'm seeking some clarity initially about, is there a similar broad across some other local authorities that you do have a chief executive who then deputises his or her role to other chief officers, who then deputises their role as a returning officer to the same people, and they're all receiving similar salaries? That's my first question.
Certainly never had a deputy chief executive to whom I could delegate responsibility. I do have 3 directors, which is an awful lot less than perhaps I used to have, but they have their own responsibilities for running their services. So I don't think the role of deputy chief executive is ubiquitous. I think, you know, it's horses for courses. Each local authority will set its own structures. I don't have a head of democratic services either. Democratic services would be rolled up in the responsibilities of a third tier officer. So, you know, we don't all have those sorts of structures. But, you know, there are good people with lots of experience in running elections who work with all of us as part of a team to deliver elections. The team effort is what counts, and you know, I think there are concerns that as we move forward, you know, some of that expertise and experience will be lost in local authorities as we have to face up to very challenging financial circumstances. But at the moment, certainly I can speak for myself, I have a very committed, experienced team, and I really look forward to working with them as we get closer to elections, and to benefit from their experience and their expertise and their teamwork, which is what gets us through what are very, very demanding times for us.
Anyone else like to add to that? Anne-Marie O'Donnell?
Yes, thank you, Convener. Like Mary, I don't have a deputy chief executive. As I've said, I have one officer who is our election coordinator. I don't have an election team. The resources that I call on in managing elections are hand-picked, and they're not necessarily grade related, it's about ability. And that's been the case in Glasgow for many years.
Okay. Mr. Barr, what's your experience?
I wish to emphasise that point briefly, Chairman, that the structures such as they are of directors, heads of service, etc., for chief executive duties are not generally replicated for elections. often the deputy returning officer will be at service manager level, but who has someone who has experience of elections.
Okay, thank you.
Then can I follow on? I mean, I've been involved in elections now for the last 17 years at every level, and I have seen how it has grown, how the yearly event has grown in capacity. But what we have found is that during that time, there has been a reduction in staff numbers across local authorities, but the election team are still expected to do a similar role that they were doing 17 years ago to ensure that they have all the policies and procedures. And we have seen a massive increase in postal votes over that time as well. So from my experience, I have seen an army of individuals having to come together to manage an election, to ensure that election is run effectively and efficiently, and they perform the role. The returning officer, in my view, is an oversee, has a coordinating role, manages from the top, and gives that direction as to where things should go. And I acknowledge the fact that the returning officer receives the money, and some may choose to distribute that money in other ways. But for the army of people that take part in an election, I wouldn't suspect that many of them would see a remuneration getting to that level.
I can only, again, speak for myself, but I would try to ensure that everybody who played a specific role over and above the day job got some form of remuneration for that for their work. But, you know, the people don't work in elections for the money. You know, we are not in it for the money. We are committed as local authority officers at whatever level to making sure that we run elections that at the end of the day we can all be proud of, and we can take some pride in the fact that everybody who's entitled to vote could vote, people were not kept waiting in queues, etc., etc. All of that is not done because there might be some money at the end of it, but because we are committed public servants who want to deliver a good job in what is a core element of our civic life and the democracy of the country. It's one of the most interesting and demanding roles that we play, but I can honestly say that the work that people deliver on our behalf and alongside us as part of the team is often the best example of that public service ethos coming through in the way that we tackle those responsibilities. And whatever the time is, I mean, on the night before the election, I have to literally close the door and push people out and tell them to go home and get some sleep, because I know they'll be back again. I'm talking midnight. I know they'll be back again at 5 a.m, manning the election office, waiting for the first call to say the janitor hasn't turned up or whatever. You know, this is not something that people do for money.
Okay. Mr. Burr?
I would just wish to emphasise that it is certainly my practice, and I'm sure the practice of all returning officers, to ensure that whichever council employees perform duties for the returning officer, there is a remuneration of some kind. That emphasises the separateness of the role.
Do you want to add anything, Anne-Marie O'Donnell, to that?
No, I think what Mary and Malcolm said is absolutely accurate. Those staff who work with me in the running of elections are all remunerated, and we have a scheme for doing that in terms of the rate that we pay associated with the responsibility that those staff undertake. And there are ongoing tasks that are looked at throughout the year in terms of new legislation and planning, for example, for next year's elections with the new counting system, that we're all familiar with how that operates so that it runs smoothly on the night.
Do you want to follow up on some of that, Alexander Stewart?
I'm content. Thank you, Convener.
Okay. Mr. Gibson.
Thank you very much, Convener. I'm Andy Hunter. In your paper, you say the returning officer duties are the personal responsibility of the returning officer, and as such are answerable directly to the courts for any question or failure in these duties. The returning officer is not responsible to the local authority. And in Mary Keithley's paper, you say, with the administration of elections is totally removed from local authorities, it can be a challenge to access the resources and staff that are necessary to deliver the polls and the count. I mean, is it not the fact that despite the supposed separation, which the papers talk about heavily, it is in reality the part of a chief executive's role to be the returning officer? I mean, for example, can a returning officer say, do you know something, I'm working 70 hours a week already. We've already heard chief executives talk about the fact that, they continue to do their day job throughout this process. So can a chief executive say, given the amount of work I'm doing and given the fact that I've got, a life outside the local authority, I'm not going to be the returning officer?
We might just take some reflections from, because I promise, Ms. Keith, we'll let you back in. Mr. Hunter, you were, this time when you were name checked, we'll allow you in first. Maybe Mr. Irvine, it'd be interesting if you've got a reflection on that before we go to those that have been the returning officers over a number of years, Mr. Hunter.
Yeah, the chief exec, unless I'm mistaken, doesn't have to accept that post. It's an appointment by the elected members of the council. They could pick someone else that they felt that wasn't impacted on their day job, if you like. So there are other ways to do that. So I don't think it's an automatic expectation that it's the chief exec that has to be, or it doesn't have to be like that, although some areas do feel like that. So if it's not appropriate for that council, then there are options available to them to work it in a different way if need be. Just in talk of resources of the council, if I can, I can give an example from my own council. We do actually bring in an external person to support the election team, because the resources available to the council now are extremely tight, and we find that's a much more suitable way than trying to take a member of staff out of their day job to support the return officer and their duties.
Okay. Mr. Irvine, I don't feel the need to answer this one, but do you have any reflections on that question before I bring our other witnesses in?
No, I think Andy's made a lot of the points that I would have made. I mean, I think across Scotland, I think, as I understand it, there's two returning officers that have been appointed by the local authority that don't also hold the job of chief executive. I think it's important to note that within the legal framework, there's a requirement for councils to put resources at the disposal of the returning officer to help them to discharge their function. And I think that is an important thing. And I think when you're looking at somebody that's a chief executive or another senior officer of the local authority, even when they're not acting in that way, they do have the ability to command resources. They have good local knowledge, which enables them to deliver the role on the ground. I mean, I think the scale and the local knowledge and experience is really important to remember. I mean, if we're talking about polling stations across Scotland, we're talking around 5,000 polling stations at an election. And I think to have people in each local authority that understand that area and have the ability to command the buildings and the premises for that use is important.
Okay, thank you. Mary Pickethley.
I suppose I was just going to reflect on the fact that, yes, there are other models that could be used. The fact that the returning officer can, if it's the chief executive or indeed any other senior officer in the particular authority, can ensure that the resources are made available for the proper running of the election. I think that's helpful. So I have heard of a situation where, because you know, our staff resources are diminishing all the time, one service and one authority had decided very late on that they couldn't release the staff to work at the election, and that they needed them at their desk. Now, the returning officer, who happened to be the chief executive, was able to say, that simply can't happen. These people have been appointed. They will turn up. I can't remember, to be honest, if it was for polling day duties or at the count, but they will turn up and they will be able to be freed up for this purpose. Now, you know, that's really important, because normally, you know, it would be difficult to replace someone at very short notice to carry out these responsibilities. They wouldn't have had the training that's required, and they wouldn't necessarily have the tools to do the job. So it is very important that we're able to say these premises can be used, these staff can be used, and we can carry on using these resources. And I think in other models where perhaps there's a centralised elections administration national office, that has been, I think, some of the issues which have bedeviled those organisations, actually trying to find those thousands of staff to work on the day, find the premises that are required, find the enumerators, etc. And I think those some of those models are looking to go back to something closer to the Scottish model, where the local knowledge and local resources are really important.
Anne-Marie O'Donnell, do you want to add anything to that?
Really, convener, just to add, well, I can only speak from a Glasgow perspective, but in running an election, there is no plan B. Polling stations need to be open at 7 o'clock on poll day. And I suppose two aspects to that are the polling stations and the polling places. A significant number of our polling stations, right, the overwhelming majority, are schools. So having worked with education for those planned elections, those schools are closed on poll day as in-service days, so that it doesn't disrupt the school year and the teaching year. And also in terms of staffing levels, in May of this year, just to put a picture of the scale of the resource, I had 2,800 people working for me that day across polling stations, across the count, across the election team, and across my constituency managers who are out and about throughout the city, making sure those polling stations are open, they're not obstructed, and we have a count and all the boxes in post 10 o'clock. And I think having those resources at my fingertips means that I can call on them. I would consider that if the election is run out with the organisation of a local authority, it would be significantly more challenging to call on those resources.
Thank you. Mr. Bird, do you want to add anything?
To add to that, sure.
Okay, I went off the topic a wee bit. The question is simply, you know, does chief executives have to do this basically job? And I understand that the answer was that 2 out of 32 they don't. A couple of things, just to follow up, convener. I find it, I don't know if everyone else feels uncomfortable at the fact that it's up to the return officer to decide whether he or she allocates some of the fee to some other member of staff, charity, or whatever it happens to be. I mean, I wasn't aware of that. I thought the fee went to that individual. Do you feel that the fee, regardless of what the fee is, should be specific to an individual and not actually, be a situation where it's up to the largesse of the returning officer as to who gets what? I mean, it seems to me a very bizarre system.
Mr. Burr?
Yes, I agree with you. I think it's an odd situation. I think just as a matter of principle, for every duty, task, responsibility given in public life, it's customary to make a payment which reflects the duties and responsibilities. That should be the same for returning officers, for deputies, for anyone else involved in the election process. And that's why I support the idea of the system being reviewed. But on that basis, I think if duties are given, and they clearly are given here, there is a very clear responsibility. Anyone involved in performing a clearly defined and accountable public duty should be appropriately remunerated. Yes,
Ms. McCaithley.
Yes, I suppose. Add is that the fee is not the only sum that's made available by Parliament for us to run elections. Obviously, each of us would have a maximum recoverable amount as well, from which we would make normal payments to polling staff, to enumerators, to members of our election team.
Yes, I was aware of that. Just one final point then.
Let me just double check. Don't feel the need to add anything, Mr. Donald. Do you want to double check? Do you want to come in?
Right. Okay. Yeah. So I didn't feel anyone was coming in there. Just one thing. I mean, everyone. I think believes, certainly in this room, as far as I'm aware, that elections are run very well and very efficiently in Scotland. I certainly have never had any complaints in the 15 elections I've contested in my many years in politics. Not a whippersnapper like Alexander Stewart here. But I notice in the paper by Andy Hunter, he says that any fee applicable to the role can also be withheld for poor performance as determined by the Secretary of State following advice of the Independent Electoral Commission. Has it ever happened in Scotland?
Mr. Hunter, and then we'll take Ailsa Irvine after that. Yeah.
I'm not aware of it happening in Scotland. I'm also not aware of any circumstance where I would probably expect it to have happened.
Yeah, the Commission has had the power to do that in certain elections since 2014, and since that period of time there's been no instances in Scotland where there's been a recommendation to withhold a fee.
And anything before that in the years
gone by? We didn't have the power previous to that. I'm not aware of any issues in the kind of immediate period preceding that would have led to that. We have a kind of clear published procedure that we would go through to make sure that we were giving due regard to all the different aspects and the reasons for whatever has arisen and how it was dealt with. But there's been no need to even invoke that procedure in the period since 2014.
Okay, thank you.
Any more questions?
No, that's fine. Thank you, Kevin.
Graham Simpson.
Thanks, Convener. Mary Pitcaithley, in your evidence, you tell us that it's councils have to appoint a returning officer. It has to be a senior officer of the council, so there's no choice in that. You also told us earlier that you're committed to making sure that elections are run smoothly, properly. We're all agreed that they are in Scotland. You're committed to public service. You're also very well paid. Chief execs are extremely well paid. Is it not reasonable to expect that chief execs or indeed senior officers should just see this as part of their job, as part of the public service that they're employed to deliver?
I think the reality is it isn't part of the day job. The day job continues, and that's what we get paid for. I think, you know, we're not saying we're not well paid, but there are many people in public service who receive significantly higher salaries than we do. I think the issue, though, is around whether or not you could just roll up these responsibilities with that of the chief executive. And I think we set out in our submission, and I think indeed so do the AEA and the Electoral Commission, so did a number of your witnesses last week, why that's not appropriate. So I wouldn't propose to rehearse all of that again. It's all there. As to whether or not there's any response, any option for a council to appoint a senior officer as a returning officer, you know, again, we're working the law that we have here. So that's the, you know, these are, there's a legal separation of duties, there's an accountability that comes with the role of returning officer that's different from the accountabilities of a chief executive or a director of law and admin or whatever the role is for the day job. And there's a level of responsibility and indeed a level of work that requires to be done, which is remunerated differently from the day job. Those are the rules that have been set out by Parliament over many, many years. They're not rules that we've devised. You know, they are what they are. And, you know, I think it's helpful that you're having a look at that. But, you know, the legislation is quite clear. The separation of duties is quite clear. And I think all of your witnesses have expressed why they think that should be a very important consideration for you before you start reviewing the wider system.
Well, I understand that very well. We all do understand that the legislation is what it is, but that's what we're here to look at, is whether that system that we have is the right system. And I think you all seem to have accepted that there is public concern over these extra payments. Certainly we're all aware of that. So the question for us is, should that system continue? What do you guys think?
Well, thank you, Chairman. I believe that the system delivers very good value to the Scottish public purse for the delivery of elections. As I've said, it's I-been to a certain extent, and therefore it may benefit. It may be time to review, but the principles of it are very important. That those who manage, declare, return at whatever level, those who are elected should not be accountable to those whom they declare elected and the processes for these processes there must be independence. The 1983 Act put that very, very boldly, almost as though to say that there should be no doubt that the person who discharges these functions holds office quite separately from whatever other role he or she holds, and usually that is Chief Executive of the Council. So if that is accepted, then I would suggest the committee might want to look at the most cost-effective way of delivering, making sure that these processes are properly observed, that elections are delivered efficiently, etc. And the current system, whatever is thought of it, certainly provides a very cost-effective way of delivering elections, as we have seen effectively.
The Mary Buchaith there, Amy O'Donnell, want to come in relation to that? Do you want to follow up?
You don't need sometimes very hefty extra fees to carry out that role independently and properly, do you?
I don't personally think the fees are can be described as hefty in all cases. They vary considerably. And as I've said earlier,
I said sometimes, Mr. Byrne.
Sometimes, yes, time. Indeed. As I have said, any system of remuneration should be separate from those who benefit from it. It is, if the committee is minded to recommend a review of how these payments are calculated and made, and there are various models for how that could be done. As my colleague from Glasgow has said, there are systems of evaluation that could be adopted. Certainly Solus would be happy to participate in such a review.
Okay. Anything to add, Mr. Simpson, in relation?
I guess the question for everyone really is if we were to get rid of fees for returning officers and move to a different system, either having no fees or spreading the fees across the team that delivers the election, would that affect the actual performance of that election team?
Anyone want to? Do you want some more clarity specifically on what's been asked? Are you suggesting that?
I'm merely asking, does money make any difference?
So would you sign up to this if you didn't get any additional money? Might be asking.
I think I've already said, convener, I don't know of any of my colleagues who take on these responsibilities lightly, and indeed I know of none of them who do it purely because there is money involved. And that, I don't think I have anything to add to that. This isn't something we're in for the money. We do this because we have a personal commitment to the same as yourselves, to upholding democracy and enabling democracy.
I'm not sure. Amy O'Donnell, did you want to add anything?
Only to say that, I mean, I have I'm very proud of my record in assisting in the running of elections for nearly 20 years and being the returning officer for the last 2 years. It does come with significant pressure. It does come with significant responsibility. I think, as my colleague reminded me, no one goes into running elections to make a career, but it can end a career. And I think that's very important. We have to deliver these elections with precision, accuracy. And if we fail to do that, then our reputation and our careers are jeopardised as a consequence of that. And I think, as Mary's already indicated, where there is work, there is usually worth, and there's recognition of the role that we do. As Malcolm has said, we're happy to participate in a review of remuneration. But I think the question I'd have is, what are you looking at? Is it the whole process of elections, or is it simply the remuneration of returning officers? And I think it's important that we don't throw the baby out with the bathwater. We look at what works very well, what's the great integrity we have in the system in Scotland for managing elections. I think, and Mary, you've indicated it's been looked at as a gold standard. Now, that doesn't happen without significant effort, but we're more than happy to contribute to a review of how that is managed.
I'm tempted to respond to that, Mr. Donald, but it's not myself who's got the line of questioning. It's Mr. Simpson, so do you want to follow up on
nope,
that?
That's fine.
Okay, Andy Whiteman.
Yes, thank you, Convener, and thank you for coming today. I mean, the inquiry is on the appropriateness of payments. In this instance, it's a short inquiry. But as you'll be aware, the Law Commissions of England, Wales and Scotland have called for a review of the law in relation to elections in general. In 10.9, they actually recommend that the lead returning officer and their functions should be governed by secondary legislation, etc. The electoral law should set out the powers and duties of returning officers for all elections within the legislative competence of the parliaments and governments of the United Kingdom. So reform is coming, I think, is broadly agreed. The councils, as you say, have to appoint an officer of the authority. Section 27 of the 1983 Act makes clear that the office of returning officer is distinct. Malcolm, you said that remuneration emphasises the separateness of the role. Surely it's Section 27 that emphasises the separateness of the role. The remuneration is governed by Section 29, and that gives returning officers the authority to make a claim up to the maximum fees, etc. And so I suppose my question, and it relates to Anne-Marie's last point, you know, a career can be jeopardised by failure to deliver an election properly. But if the roles are distinct, presumably that's just your career as a returning officer over. It wouldn't impact on your career as a chief executive.
Before you answer that, Mr. Burr, would want anyone's career to be over, I should point out. Mr. Burr, do you want to come in on that?
I think the experience of some chief executives who happen to be returning officers in other jurisdictions may give rise to questions as to whether it's the career of the returning officer that is jeopardised rather than chief executive. But on the point of principle, I think where there is a distinct set of responsibilities of a statutory nature, giving personal legal responsibility for any act, it is a contract has been entered into, as it were, for the discharge of these duties, and it is both appropriate and customary that where duties are required of that nature and of that level of importance, that is reflected by some means of remuneration.
Okay, Ms. McCaithley, Anne-Marie O'Donnell, do you want to add anything to that?
Would you accept, Mr. Burr, that it's not the remuneration that emphasises the separateness of the role, it's the statutory provisions in Section 27, and that in theory, in future, those statutory provisions in 27 that emphasise the distinctiveness of the role could remain if the returning officer's role were wrapped into a chief executive role, and they would emphasise that when undertaking that role, they are no longer accountable to the council as they are in their chief executive role, and they almost step out of that, so that the statutory provisions can continue to insist that this is a separate role, but that the remuneration itself has no role to play in emphasising that distinction.
Yes, you're correct. The statute gives the responsibility. That would obviously require a discussion between individual returning officers and the councils which appoint them. But yes, the Act could simply declare who holds the role, provided that the independence of the role was safeguarded in law. Yeah.
And finally, the provisions of Section 29 allow for the fee to include any pension payments. Are you aware of if the fees do include pension payments routinely, or is it up to the returning officer to make a claim for that?
Certainly my own does not, and I think that's the position across... I can't speak for all of Scotland.
But I think it differs depending on the legislation that's passed. So more recently, the provision for payments to be superannuable has not applied. It was it was a more something that was more common previously. But these are matters for Parliament when they when they're looking at the fees and charges order.
Anyone else want to add to that?
I suppose I would just want to pick up Mr. Whiting's very important point about the Law Commission reviews. I think the Law Commissions across the UK are working very closely together on a review. And I think you know that holistic process of looking at how the whole system, including the legislation and these sorts of issues, can be updated, modernised, kept fresh, kept as clear as possible for the benefit of voters, is something that we've been very, very supportive of. And I think there are issues around whether or not picking individual aspects of that out in one jurisdiction in the UK, potentially not mirrored elsewhere, would be something that you might want to consider.
Okay. Anyone else want to add? Mr. Hunter, you'd wanted to come in, I think?
I was just going to actually touch on the same things about superannuation. It's not in every... So referendums generally don't allow for that. Returning officers do, by choice, decide whether they do that or not. But I think in any aspect, as I think Mr. Burr has indicated, a review of the actual payments, that would be an element that would also need to be considered, whether that was the right thing to be doing as part of that remuneration.
Finally, we heard evidence last week, I apologise, I don't recall the witness, who said that these remunerations are made not because of the labour, but because of the significant responsibility that goes with this role. We've heard from Mary Piketty this morning that, in fact, it is, at least in part, for labour. You are working weekends, you're working extra hours to deliver this. Can you give us some flavour of the extent to which you feel that remuneration is a reward for responsibility and or the labour?
I would like to illustrate that by way of example, Chair, if I may. My colleague Alistair Buchan, the returning officer for Orkney, members may recall, found himself incurring legal fees and being a party to an action in the election court following the disputed election of the MP for Orkney and Shetland, despite the fact no party to that action questioned the conduct of the election. That is an example, I would suggest, of the personal responsibility. That has nothing to do with his employer. The fees there become the responsibility of the returning officer, even where the conduct of the election is not is not in question. And that is perhaps an example of that the payment, notionally, I would have to say, in that case, reflects responsibility as well as hard work.
Any other comments from witnesses before Mr. White?
No, I don't think they are mutually exclusive. I think it would be for carrying out the entire duties as laid out in the various bits of legislation. So it would be to reflect the levels of accountability and responsibility as exemplified there, but also the tasks that have to be carried out, many of which are time critical and require a huge amount of coordination.
Could just one final point. That's helpful, Mr. Burr. The example you gave from Orkney. Are you aware if the returning officer incurred any personal costs in relationship to his involvement in the legal action?
I'm not personally aware of that.
But if such a returning officer did find themselves either as a party at some distance or directly involved in a legal action, they would be personally liable for meeting their legal costs, is the case.
That has to be the case, sir, yes, unless the costs are covered by insurance.
I think one of your evidence suggests that insurance is routinely bought in by returning officers. Is that, presumably that's up to returning officers, but do you have any indication as to how many returning officers do insure themselves against legal costs or not?
I should imagine that all do, but not insurance policies, as we all know, do not always cover every eventuality.
Okay, Mr. Hunter?
Just to add to the insurance and the personal liability, insurance won't cover what would technically be considered a fine, so the requirements for the return officer to comply with the Data Protection Act, should someone within the running officer's scope, breached the Data Protection Act, and the Commissioner felt the need to issue a fine. That fine would actually be personal to the returning officer, and the insurance, as I understand it, insurance policies wouldn't cover that. So there's only so much that can be done. So there are personal liabilities and dangers out there for returning officers that simply insurance wouldn't sort out.
And I do think there are issues around reputation, as my colleague from Glasgow has outlined earlier as well. We saw what happened in Barnet earlier this year, where the returning officer, chief executive of the local council, I think resigned very quickly after a bit of a difficulty that occurred in relation to the registers that were available in polling stations. That had such an impact.
Okay, Mr. Whitman. Can I maybe I don't know what's a question. Please indicate. I've got one final question I would like to ask, and that's in relation to, I suppose, the sum of evidence. So the level of payments depends on the size of the local authority. It depends on whether it's a European or a UK election, which would be determined at a UK level. If it's a Scottish election, I think it's determined in this place. Local authority election, it's determined at a local authority level. There's a variety of practices in relation to how returning officers decide to dispose of the income that they get, irrespective of how much that income is. There's a variety of practices in relation to that. Sometimes it's disclosed, sometimes it's not disclosed. There was a discussion around what additional burdens that places, not responsibilities, but additional workload burdens that places on local authority chief executives in their capacity as returning officer, whether there's a displacement effect or do other people pick up work elsewhere, which was where I started my line of questioning in relation to the interaction between that substantial chief executive salary and additional monies to be returning officer. So I'm wondering, this might be more for Mr. Hunter and Ms. Irvine, but just given that kind of muddied or inconsistent approach to everything, irrespective of the level of payment to returning officers, is there a need for more clarity and more consistency, and does there have to be changes? And if you think there does, it's a bit like leading the witness, I know, if you think that there does need to be, we will eventually make some recommendations. What do you think might be a good direction of travel, Mr. Hunter?
Yeah, I think we've at the very beginning we outlined that there's always should be a necessary for review. It's always worth open and transparent. If there are public concern there about whether it's the amounts or the actual payments, then yeah, absolutely, we should look at that and try and make that as transparent and clear as possible, whether it's changed or not as part of any review. The consistency, yeah, I think we would benefit widely that there was a bit more consistent approach to that. So whoever's actually deciding how that's maybe calculated or worked, and I think Ms. O'Donnell referred to job evaluation schemes as one way to sort of look at that, and yeah, I certainly would be happy to be involved in part of that review looking at the information there.
Okay, Ailsa Irvine, do you want to add anything to that?
Yeah, I mean, I think from the Commission's perspective, I think absolutely, as I said earlier, happy to be involved in any review. I think the important thing is safeguarding the principles of independence and accountability and making sure that anything we go into is fully evidence-based and considers all the risks of any change to the system. One thing I would say in relation to transparency, in relation to the EU referendum in June of this year, the Commission is responsible for distributing the fees and charges which were set by the UK Parliament, but we distribute them. And what we will do once we have received all the accounts and all the claims for fees and charges for the election is we will publish a comprehensive report giving transparency, showing how that money was spent at that election. And we've been calling on the Scottish Parliament and the UK Parliament to do the same in relation to European, UK and Scottish parliamentary elections in 14, 15 and 16. And we look forward to seeing that being published to give greater transparency of what elections are costing.
That's very helpful. I'm going to follow up on that, but I just want to indicate to our other witnesses that we're about to close the evidence session. I'll give you an opportunity to make some final comments if you wish. We'll come to that in a second. But in relation to that call to the Scottish and UK parliaments or governments in relation to that data and the publishing of that and the consistency, I'll be very interested to see what the Electoral Commission does publish in relation to that. But in terms of how you publish it, is there a need for, again, consistency? So publishing in the same way, using the same criteria, presented in the same way? Should there be a read across so we can look at each of these elections and the lines by which you decide which payments go where and why they're made? Should that be the same across all elections? Is there some joint working in relation to this?
I think there would certainly be a help. It would be good to understand the kind of comparison of costs and to be able to do analysis of the data and to understand what we're getting for our money as well. So I think that absolutely could be the case, particularly given we're working the legal frameworks in terms of how the maximum recoverable amounts are set are very similar. I don't think that would be particularly difficult to achieve if there was joint working. And from the Commission's perspective, from our role in the June referendum, we'd be more than happy to be involved in that.
Now, I think Mr. Whiteman has been gesticulating towards me, wishes a brief supplementary. Yes, Mr. Whiteman?
It's just a final little question. I mean, Mr. Hunter from the Association of Electoral Administrators, are returning officers members of your association?
Yeah, not all. It's obviously not automatic, but there are a large number of returning officers that are members of the association here. Yeah.
And therefore, when they travel to your, I see you have an annual conference in February this next year, do they do that under their own holiday time, at their own expense, out of the returning officer payments?
I couldn't answer for each individual returning officer.
Okay, thanks.
Okay, I think we'll leave that hanging there. I did say what we'd do is we'd give our local authority chief executives who have been returning officers on a number of occasions, and there has been successful running of elections in Scotland despite the fact that we're looking at the appropriateness of those payments across all elections, and we will report on that and potentially make some recommendations. I think it would be appropriate not just to thank you for coming along today, but give you the opportunity for any final comments you wish to make, if you wish to take us up on that offer. Mr. Bird, do you want to?
Very briefly, Chairman, I think we are in the happy position of discussing a system which delivers well. That system places personal legal responsibility for a complex range of tasks and returning officers. It is a system which has grown incrementally, there's no doubt about that, and like any system, it would benefit from time to time from a review, and Solace Scotland will certainly be happy to participate in any such review.
Okay, Mary Keithley, do you want to add anything?
No, I have nothing to add to that. Thank you very much.
Okay, can I thank all our witnesses this morning, and that concludes agenda item 5, and we now move into private session. Thank you. Suspend.